we'll go ahead and get started. Thank you everyone for joining us, including our panelists. Thank you so much for being here. In a few moments, all the panelists will introduce themselves, share a little bit about their career, share a little bit of their work, where you can find them. But I also wanted to talk about creative experience. So creative experience is the department in the library that's hosting this event tonight. We're a digital makerspace. So we have two locations, one at Bar Library at 1701 South Jefferson and a central library location at 1301 Olive. And it's a location where people can do large format prints. We have artists who will print their art on, we have canvas paper, so people will reproduce their art on canvas. They can 3D print, they can laser cut out of wood and acrylic. And we also have computers that just have things like game design software, audio software, video design software, 3D modeling, animation, all types of stuff, including the full Adobe suite. And all this is available free with your library card. So as a creative sector of the library, we also like to celebrate artists, and that's what we do these artist panels for. So we started last year with the Hispanic Heritage Month panel in October. Then in February, we did a Black History Month program or Black History Month panel. In March, we did a Women's History Month panel. This month, we're doing the Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month panel. And next month, we'll be doing the Pride panel for LGBTQIA+ artists. And then again in October, we'll be doing another Hispanic Heritage Month panel. So thank you very much for supporting and for watching these. This will be recorded tonight. The only people during the webinar that have a camera on automatically are our panelists. So if you're an attendee, you don't have to worry, your camera is not on. And this will be recorded and available on our YouTube channel along with all of our other panels. We will have 10 questions that the panelists will answer. I will be asking and moderating the program. If you have any just comments during the program, feel free to put those into the chat. Artists, if you'd like to put your websites in the chat, please feel free to. And at the end of all of our question and answer during the panel, the audience will have the ability to ask questions if they'd like to. So without further ado, I believe we're starting with Rachel. For introductions?
Yeah, cool. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, sweet. Hi, everybody. Thanks for attending tonight. I'm Rachel. I use they, them pronouns. I currently live in St. Louis. I graduated from Washington University in St. Louis in 2017, and I've chosen to stay here for 5 years since. But sadly, we'll be departing in the fall to go to grad school. But yeah, thank you for the invitation to be here. Do I start with my work now or do I wait for everybody else to introduce themselves first?
Oh, no, go ahead. These few minutes are for you. Yep.
Okay, cool. I'm just going to give a quick intro to my work. Keep it under 5 minutes. I'm just going to share screen. And yeah, I just have a couple slides. But yeah, so I'm a sculptor. I mainly work with a lot of found objects, mainly used ones. And so kind of the work that I feel like I'm most known for right now is this like series of kinetic sculptures where I'm basically taking artificial plants and attaching them to massager bodies. And these massagers are oftentimes, or for the always, they're going to be secondhand, and a lot of them are local. So a lot of these I source from the St. Louis area, and then kind of upset their function of like being massaging, like comforting tools, and letting them do these kind of weird dances instead. In 2020, I was fortunate to participate in the 2020 Great Rivers Biennial at the Contemporary Art Museum in St. Louis. So as part of this exhibition, I opened up a show called Gather, which I'll play some video from here while I talk over. But if you had a chance to see this show, it was really fun. This was the first time I had scaled, put all of my work into like a big scale exhibition. I created this like really immersive environment, which felt like both like a dance floor, but also had these elements of feeling like a church service, which is pulled from like my own kind of personal narrative of growing up in a conservative Korean Baptist upbringing. And so, yeah, you basically entered this this space, and you had all these like dancing flowers and plants that looked like they were kind of worshiping, but also joyously celebrating, which came at, you know, the kind of the early months of the pandemic. And so it was also a time where people were not actually like physically gathering. Just to show a few more things, I've staged this exhibition in various iterations around the country. Currently, it's actually in Berlin, and kind of played with different spaces and thinking about like, what is it like to show this work in a basement in a small gallery versus like a commercial gallery versus a museum, and playing with those associations. And I'll show just one more piece, which is recent. This is from 2022, where I kind of restaged these works in more of a like religious church setting, which I called Sermon. Again, really referencing my own kind of ties to my religious upbringing and like Korean heritage and all the associations that that brought on. So, so yeah, that's like a quick shot of what that show looks like. And I will leave it at that. Cool. All right. I'm going to stop sharing. Awesome.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing. And again, if you have a website or anything that you want to drop in the chat, I think as long as you put it on everyone, but the attendees and your fellow panelists will be able to see it. Go right ahead.
Okay, it's my turn, right? Okay, hi there. My name is Jiwoo Kim. I go by they, them, also a St. Louis-based artist. As far as art schooling goes, the most I got an associate's in fine arts at the community college here in St. Louis. Aside from that though, I did not have anything prepared to show people today, so I'm just gonna just talk about some stuff real quick, because for me, like right now, my art is it's been changing a lot, and it's sort of been in different places, but usually an overall theme that my art usually goes around is a connection between nature and people. Although lately I haven't been putting a lot of personal stuff out there, but you know, I've always dealt with imposter syndrome, as far as being a half age, like half Korean, half white, and then also this is very new to me. I don't generally like talking about myself. This is going to be kind of interesting today. But yeah, dealing with the imposter syndrome and sort of reclaiming my Korean that was sort of suppressed growing up, even though I grew up with my Korean mother. But yeah, it's probably more, but I'm just going to leave it at that before I start babbling on about stuff.
Thank you for sharing. And again, if you have a website you'd like to place in the chat, mm-hmm. feel free to.
Of course.
And then next, I think we have Yuko.
I have to figure out how to unmute myself in time. So, but I completely empathize, you know, with Jiwoo as well, because I am not used to talking about myself. I am far more comfortable just letting my art be out there as opposed to me, and I will avoid photographs of myself to be posted for different things at all costs as well. Just ask the Craft Alliance Registrar. Poor Robert has been hounding me for about a year now. So I think that that's just kind of, you know, the way some of us are in terms of we would rather our work speak for ourselves than visually. I am actually a native St. Louisan. I have formal training in metals from WashU back when. And I've taught at Craft Alliance for, oh goodness, maybe 20 years or so. I teach metals and glass, but really the focus more is on glass. I'd really like to see that promoted in the studio. So really trying hard to get some interest going there. And really, you know, kind of starting to look at switching from what started off as more, let's make pieces of jewelry and let's, you know, find ways to make beautiful things to wear, to shift over into, you know, being a part of my community and just seeing so many different things happening, you know, over the past, well, for quite a while. But I think growing up in a culture where I'm supposed to be maybe seen, but definitely not heard, it's been a process of being comfortable enough to put my thoughts out there, and to be able to put some things out into the open as far as, you know, these are things on my mind. And even if I'm not saying a word, perhaps my work can speak for me. So Anna, if you happen to have the slides that I sent that you're able to put on a screen share, you know, I could certainly talk about that a little bit as well. So, and this one's super teeny tiny. This is one that I've worked on for about the past 5 years, and I was very hesitant to put this one out today because of the things that have happened this week, but it certainly looks at the issues of gun violence and how it's affecting a lot of individuals. I've been fortunate enough to work with the World Chess Hall of Fame, and it's just been a wonderful medium to look at the two sides of an issue and just how they come together. So this is one of my more recent works. And Anna, if you don't mind switching back to one of the other ones. Oh, perfect. This one's in their permanent collection, and it really kind of looks at how the individual, really your biggest competitor, is yourself. There are mirrors in the back, as well as mirrors for the individual squares on a chessboard. And so every time you move a piece, then your reflection is then making a move as well. So it's just that commentary on looking at, you know, what are you competing with, or what are you comparing yourself to? And realistically, it should be yourself and challenging yourself to develop your skills versus looking at an opponent as an enemy or as someone who, you know, you need to crush and destroy, just looking to better yourself in the process. And then there's one more chess set, which kind of started the whole thing about 5 or 6 years ago.
Sorry, minor technical difficulty. Give me one moment.
You're fine. And we don't even have to do it because I know we're probably running out of time, and I want Anna to make sure she gets her time in as well. So, oh, I like the reindeer antlers though. So, you know what? For the sake of time, why don't we switch gears and just go ahead and switch over to Anna Cruz?
Thank you. Hi guys. My name's Anna. I use she, her pronouns. I have actually only been in St. Louis for about a year and a half now, so I'm a little bit of a newbie when it comes to St. Louis. I'm an illustrator and an artist and a designer. I kind of do everything. I can't ever decide on what I want to do. So let me share my screen and just share some work with you guys. Give me one second. Okay, so nice to meet you guys. This is a baby picture of me. I was born in the Philippines, and I moved here when I was 13 to Orlando. I'm primarily a painter and illustrator, do a lot of work with figuration, and color is really important in my work. I like building these worlds that feel like they're like the internal kind of worlds that these characters that I make live in. So I've been making paintings for about 10 years now. I graduated with a BFA in fine art from UCF, which is in Central Florida. I also have done a couple collaborative mural work. I do a lot of collaborative work with my husband. We've been making work for probably 5 years now. Here's another mural that we did together. Yeah, I really enjoy using color in my work a lot. And then probably 2 years ago or 3 years ago, I started getting interested in kind of working with people and collaborating with local business owners. So I work a lot with local businesses that are not, I guess not local anymore because I don't live in Orlando anymore, but I work a lot with small businesses to kind of figure out visual identities for them. So it's really fun because I feel like I get to learn a lot about what they do. And I tend to kind of attract businesses that are very similar to things I'm interested in. So the one that I showed before is an herbalist based in Miami. This one right here, it was for an acupuncturist in Orlando. And I've also been doing quite a few like local clients here in St. Louis. I did this comic panel for Know How, which is a bookshop in the Luminary. And I've done poster design for them as well. I just like having fun and making sure that like the work I make really represents like what the people that I work with, like what their vision, I guess. This one was a project I made with Cam for their fundraiser, which actually just happened this last April. And then this most recent one I'm working with a Filipino restaurant that's opening in Orlando. Really exciting because I've always wanted to make work that's, you know, about my heritage, and it's nice to align with people who are doing that as well and making sure that there's more presence, Filipino presence in America. So yeah, that is my work. Thank you for watching my slides.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for sharing. We'll get to know a lot more about you through the questions for the panel. And then again, for our attendees, if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat. We won't address them till the end of our panel. But as they come to you, so if you don't want to forget them, you can put them in the chat. And also at the bottom of your screen, there should be an option that says Q&A. You can also put questions in there as well. Either way works. I'm going to post yours again. It looks like you might have just sent it to us rather than to the attendees. So I just put it in there again for you. Okay. So without further ado, we'll start with our questions. So just kind of starting out, we want to kind of know about your background just related to art. So to begin, we want to know, where do you find the inspiration to create? Does your work require you to create with intention, or can you wait for inspiration to strike? And anyone feel free to unmute and start.
I feel like for me, a lot of my art, well, again, it's hard to say right now because a lot of the stuff I put out there has just been mostly commissioned work at the moment, but it's a lot of really personal experiences for me, which is sometimes why I hesitate to put art out there, because it can be a very vulnerable thing for me to have to put stuff out. Yeah, but aside from that, though, sometimes it is a matter of just sort of just hoping and praying that, you know, that thunder will strike. You're like, oh my God, that's the thing.
I've learned to add that I'm 100% motivated by deadlines, and I've learned this from procrastinating through most of my school and academic life and putting myself into total crisis mode. But I try to keep myself busy with, like, you know, either like real deadlines that I have to meet or like arbitrary ones, whether those are like application deadlines, just to keep myself going. Otherwise, I would say like my studio practice is like pretty like playful, but like not like super like quote unquote productive until like it's time to like put something out there. Yeah,
I totally agree with the deadline part. I feel like a lot of the times I don't find the energy or the inspiration if I don't tell myself that I need to work on it. But I think a lot of the times too, because I do a lot of client work, I feel like I want to make something that's just for myself. So I've been doing that. I mean, I continue to do that with the client work as well, even though sometimes I feel a little stretched thin. But yeah, it's mostly just dealing with my own neuroses and like expressing things that I feel like I can't express with words. It comes out in the work, I feel like.
Absolutely, I agree. There are so many times when I just can't put the words in the right place to come up with it, or I just don't feel comfortable saying a lot of those things I'm thinking out loud. So, you know, when I'm seeing a lot of things that I feel are just unfair or inequality or things that just bother me enough, that's the type of thing that gets my brain going. And 3 a.m, just waking up, and that's usually the time when those things kind of come together, when I'm not overthinking it, but my brain just has that little bit of a moment to kind of sort it out. And then I just have to jot it down and then go back to sleep.
Do you feel like, this is sort of like a follow-up to this question, do you feel like work that has been either commissioned or been requested feels different creatively than work that you're making just for yourself?
All the time, for sure. Because for me, like, the commission stuff can, well, depending on what it is, it can be a lot easier just because it's like you don't really have to think about it too hard because you know what the person wants, versus something where I know what I want, but can I make that be, you know, can I make that a thing, like, come to life? It's always different.
Yeah, I totally agree. I feel like in the moment when I'm making client work, it's really hard for me to enjoy myself sometimes, but and that's why I keep doing work for myself, I think, just because having that, I think for me, it's like nice to have a balance between having complete control with what it is that I want to do and then also giving myself boundaries. And I think that's where like the commission work really helps produce work, where I'm like, okay, I have these rules, and it makes making a little easier sometimes. But I've also been really lucky recently that I feel like a lot of the people that I've been working with really are looking for the kind of work that I want to produce. So I've been kind of lucky in that regard. It's getting a little bit more fun over time to do that stuff.
I think it's actually more difficult for me to do like just like what I want, because like there's a measure with like working with other people, like what they're looking for, and that like gives you more restraints, which is like kind of like an assignment with that you're almost working within. But something that I'm like remembering when we're like having this conversation is that like also like there are these ideas that like inspiration can strike you, and like there are days where you're like really loving to go into the studio, but a lot of the time like artwork is work, like it is like labor and it's time, and it's not like fun a lot of the time. Like there's times where I'm like totally grooving in the studio and it's like amazing, and then there's times where I'm like, let's go get in the car, go to studio, like, you know, treat it like a job, because like when it's your professional experience, you do have to do things sometimes when you don't want to.
So I'm in agreement with Anna too, because, you know, I don't typically accept commissioned work just because I have a hard time with those constraints and the deadlines. And but I will, if they are individuals who know my work and who already know sort of my style, and otherwise I am happy to refer them to another artist friend, you know, who may be more in line with what they're looking for.
Yeah, sometimes it feels really good to just say no to things.
Awesome. Well, thank you, everyone. Any other thoughts about creation and inspiration before we move on to the second question? Awesome. So moving on to more about your background. So what was your childhood like in regards to art or just creativity? Was being an artist or art in general always a part of your life?
You're asking a bunch of Asians to jump in and talk. You do realize like there's a challenge in that in and of itself, right? So just, you know, for me, it's interesting because, you know, my parents are immigrants from Japan. And so there was always that sense of like, it's nice to have a hobby, But you better find something that will pay the bills, something steady, something safe, something secure, because I think when they've experienced war as children and have that insecurity and food insecurity, I think it then generates the sense of security at all cost. So there was definitely the, it's nice, but make sure you have something that's going to pay the bills and keep the lights on. So it's definitely been a process.
I feel like my mom must have been like the anti-Asian, because she didn't really care about that kind of stuff at all. If anything, my mom looks down on education a lot of the time. But I think it's also because her background, like she never, I don't think my mom ever finished like high school or something like that. So for her, you know, if we're doing that thing, then she just automatically thinks that people look down on her because of that. But yeah, no, it's always been a big part of me though, because I had a bit of a rough childhood growing up. So it's been therapy before I had real therapy, which is very different.
Therapy is
Can your
best.
Mom hang out with my mom? Just asking.
Yeah, I'll go next. I always had art in my life as like drawing and painting. Like I always like to just like sketch and draw, which is like kind of weird how I ended up doing what I'm doing now. But I wouldn't say my parents were like completely unsupportive. They just like didn't know how I was gonna be an artist. And like granted, neither did I or like anybody else around me. But like luckily through like generous scholarships and things like that, like I was able to take my education the way I wanted to. And so I definitely like see myself in this like privileged path of being like a first gen artist, like where like my parents, you know, got us here and set up this foundation. And then like, I'm the one who's like allowed to like take the risk of like doing this very individualistic, high risk kind of like pathway. So yeah.
I feel very similarly. I actually like, so my, we didn't have a lot of artists in my family. I had an aunt who was an architect and I really looked up, like I grew up just watching her draw. And I think that was like one of the things that inspired me to be an artist. And I was an introvert. So I just like, we would have like talent shows at my school and I just didn't want to perform. So I chose drawing as a talent every time. And my dad, like always, he's actually here right now. Hi, Dad. He actually always like fostered that in me. I feel like he like saw that I was interested and always was supportive. And my parents are always telling us that, like, because my sister's a writer and I'm an artist, and my brother like likes to make things. So they always say that the reason they moved us here is because they wanted us to be able to succeed. So that's, I always try to think about that, because I do feel very privileged that I get to like live this life, because I feel like if I stayed in the Philippines, I don't know if I would be doing the things I'm doing now. Probably not, honestly. Or I mean, it would be different.
Do you feel like, and this is for all of you, do you feel like if you ended up having to be in a position where art was just a hobby, you know, as you go saying, okay, it's a hobby, but okay, what's your real job? Do you think that you would still feel as inspired to create if it wasn't paying the bills or like part of that type of like career in art? Do you think that inspiration and creativity would be the same? There's no wrong, right or wrong answer here.
So
it's like,
go ahead. Sorry, we're all kind of jumping in at the same time. So I may be one of the few people who actually has a day job that's unrelated to the art side of me as well. So that has been a bit of a compromise, but at the end of the day, I actually feel like they sort of enhance one another, because I do community-based practice as a therapist. And so when I'm out in these different communities, I do get to see these different things going on that I may not normally see within my own smaller community. And it just provides a really nice resource for some ideas and just looking at common themes among everyone, you know, regardless of what area you're living in or what your background may be. So I think there's a way to have them sort of complement one another and not necessarily have to be an either or, but it has taken a while for me to get to that point.
Yeah, earlier I was about to say, I was like, well, when art actually does pay the bills, I answer that question. But, you know, it just, you know, it pays some of them, but it's not like a consistent thing. So I still have to work a bunch of part-time jobs, which honestly, some, you know, I don't hate them, you know, and they do contribute, I think, to my, because a lot, you know, like when it comes to my more personal work, it comes to my day-to-day life usually. And yeah, so it does play a part in that. Otherwise, I am a complete introvert, and this, it gets me out of the house and sees people when I don't have to work my normal job.
Yeah, I was about, I've always had a day job. I still have a day job. but, you know, I feel like the more I just like keep with the art practice and keep with, you know, just being consistent with making work, I feel like it's starting to happen where they are informing each other, like Yuka was saying. Because right now I'm working as an illustrator for an agency, and I'm like, for the first time in my life, getting to be like an illustrator for 40 hours a week. And that's been really, it feels really good. So it's like, I've only been doing that for like 3 months now, but yeah, I do agree that it's like, they totally inform each other. And I don't think of it as a hobby, even if it doesn't really pay the bills. I still like to take it seriously, which is, I think, maybe where the difference lies.
I also have a full-time job. I work like a full administrative position. And I think that's the reality, unless you're like a blue chip artist, like straight out of like school, which is like being like the Brad Pitt of actors, right? Like you just have to be like the one. So yeah, I think, you know, I've worked more than 40 hours a week and then like squeezed art in like wherever I could. And I think, you know, it's like exhausting, but also provided me to make work, like the freedom to make work that like was free of like that need to sell. Because if you look at like work, it's not exactly like the most commercially viable, like it still sells, but it's like not like at the rate of like painting, for example. So in a way, like me having a job like allowed me to just like do whatever I want in studio and like be like excited if I make some money off of it, but also like not disappointed if I like, you know, was like in debt, you know, for 1 year or something. So yeah, it's gonna be weird like going into grad school, because like I'll be doing a sculpture program and it's like I will have all my time to myself, and I'm actually kind of like a little terrified because I've never had so much time to make work and like structure my day myself. I really actually do like my day job, because kind of like Ju said, like it's nice to see people, because otherwise I probably would like never see people if I didn't like leave my house for work.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for sharing. Yeah, I definitely think it's the reality for most artists that they're like 9 to 5 is nothing related. And sometimes, yeah, people get lucky and they can do some semi-related one, but I think it's pretty rare for someone to only make art and then that magically pays all the bills. If art was more widely respected and did, you know, get purchase more often, maybe the way that was, you know, years ago when that was the form of entertainment, then that might be a little bit different. But yeah, I agree. I think it's definitely reality, unfortunately, for a lot of artists. Awesome. Any other thoughts anyone want to add before we move on to the next question?
I was thinking about this TED Talk that talked about, I don't know if everyone's seen it before, but the creative genius. It was pretty funny. Yeah, it was really great. If you have a chance to check it out, you should. But it was really funny because she was talking about like the whole notion between like, I don't know if it's necessarily about starving artists, but like art and suffering. And like for some reason it's just the creative like sectors that have to deal with this like stereotype of suffering. You know, like, oh, you know, like it, and one of the examples the lady had in the TED Talk was like, you know, oh, like you have an art block, an artist block or something like that. And then she was talking about how maybe someone's like an engineer, it's like, oh, you got like engineering block today or something, you know, people don't ask that question, you know, versus like a creative block.
Suffering is not sustainable. I like, so my day job is recruiting students to WashU's art school and also the architecture school. And I like constantly have to just like hammer that into the students. And I'm like, you have to eat well, like sleep. And like, you cannot like, you know, pull 3-day all-nighters and like eat out of the vending machine for like the rest of your life. Your body will like literally collapse in on itself. So yeah, I think that's one thing is like being out of school, like, yeah, there's that narrative. Like, I feel like Vincent Van Gogh was like the big artist like learned about growing up as like a kid, and like he had like a horrible time and then like killed himself. And like, that is not like the singular narrative of like how artists like operate and does not need to be.
Yeah, I'm actually glad we're talking about that, because I feel like that's something I've really had to unlearn in the last 10 years. I'm like telling myself that it's okay to not produce as much work if it means that I'm taking care of myself and everything else in my life. And it's good too, because you're not putting like all your worth into your work, which is, I feel, really unhealthy.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone. So moving on to our next question, we've already kind of touched on this a little bit, but what is your relationship with your heritage and your culture? Is it good? Is it bad? Is it complicated? Sometimes I feel like it's usually complicated.
I would say for me, it's definitely very much complicated. I didn't really feel like I filled in my skin, but until maybe a few years back. So this is all very new to me, like really kind of reclaiming a side of me that was never, just nurtured. You know, my mom looked at all my siblings and I, and just calls us just Americans, just sees us as white kids, even though we are hers. So yeah. There's more.
So I think it's also a complicated question, because I think there's your heritage, and then I think there's culture, sort of like your general, you know, culture of nationality and such. But then I think there's also family culture, which can be different than, you know, like for me, it's like there's Japanese culture, but then my family's culture is a little bit different within that. So it's a broad question that I think is additionally complex, because I think everyone has their own individual family dynamics and lenses that get layered on there as well. For me, it's definitely complicated. I grew up in St. Louis during a time when there weren't many Asian people living here. So I was constantly being told to be a good example. You know, so don't let all Asians be judged on your bad behavior. So the expectation of stay under the radar, be compliant, assimilate, it's so refreshing to see that that is no longer the norm. That made for some really challenging times, you know, growing up. And I think one of the reasons I kind of tend to be sort of rooting for the underdog at all times too. So perhaps that's not all just a bad thing. It's just part of that, you know, it's what makes me who I am. So, yeah.
Yeah, my siblings and I actually moved here. It's really interesting, because like, especially with the Korean community here that I grew up with in like West County, like that's like where all the Koreans are. And it was like, we moved here from Japan, because my dad was military. So we lived in Misawa before we came here after my parents divorced. So my only exposure to like I guess that side is just like the Korean church, which isn't a really good representation. But yeah.
Mine's also complicated. yeah, it's interesting. I had a really confusing teenage, I mean, I'm sure we all did, but it was really confusing, because moving here, like when I was 13, and like, it was like me and my parents, we were trying to figure out this whole new world that we really didn't know about before. So I think a lot of the times because of like just wanting to survive, we all just like assimilation felt really like essential at that time. And then when I grew up, I think like probably it wasn't really until like my later 20s, which is I just turned 30. So it's not, it hasn't been that long. So, but yeah, more recently I've been trying to embrace it more and, trying to build a community where I actually like know a lot of people who have the same or very similar kind of heritage as I do. It's interesting because in Orlando, I didn't really know any Filipinos at all. And when I moved here, I've met quite a few Filipinos who I consider our friends and who are also artists. So it's been really nice to just kind of discover that part of myself. I didn't think I would find it in St. Louis, but it's pretty magical that it's happening. And it makes me feel really comfortable in my skin the more I hang out with people who are like very similar as me.
I would say, yeah, I've never grown up anywhere. Like, I don't think I've ever really had like community, like in the kind of traditional, like cultural sense. But I think like, as I've reflected over the past few years, like I feel really fortunate that I live in a time where like the narrative of diaspora is like really like multiplicitous. Like, it's not just like, I think when I was a kid, it was a lot simpler. Like, I was like, oh, I feel like I should be white, but I'm like Asian. And it was like a denial of culture and acceptance of white culture and erasure. And you know, those are certainly still like part of like my life, but I feel like through like, you know, even like internet communities or meeting people through school, like there's so many like ways of being an Asian American, you know, of whatever generation here that is, doesn't feel like you're lacking because you like, you know, like I don't speak Korean, I've never been to Korea. And you know, that it's taken me a long time to not feel like that makes me like less Korean or like, you know, a certain percentage this way or that way. And I feel like that's really been kind of a thing in the recent years. Like, I don't, you know, I think being a kid growing up, like in a mostly white, like school is like different than like being connected on the internet with like, you know, thousands and thousands of people who feel very much the same way. So it's been amazing.
And of course, and for someone like me, as far as like finding community goes, it's interesting for me because it's like, especially being queer and Asian is an interesting, you know, like trying to figure that out in St. Louis. So I ended up actually creating a group specifically for like queer and trans people of color. It's a creatives collective. It's still pretty new. You know, we have some like meetups every now and then, but that's just, yeah, trying to figure that out.
Kind of recalling something that Yoko said about this being a like a broad question as far as like your family culture and then your culture that's tied towards ethnicity and race. Do you feel like you would have had a different like different experience with your culture and different feeling towards it if there had been more of a like a actual culture here in St. Louis or even in Florida? Like, I'm from the Bay Area. And so part of my family is Filipino. And I mean, that's a huge population and just diversity in general is so different in St. Louis compared to the Bay Area and California. It's night and day. And so I don't know if we kind of hear as often as people saying not having that connection to culture, but I hear it a lot in St. Louis for the different cultures, the Hispanics that are here and the Asian communities that are here. So do you think you would have a different relationship if there were larger communities? Like, if you could have been more involved in those communities, do you think you would be different, or do you think it's about your family culture?
So I'm running into the thing of where I may be jumping ahead. But so really with my family, my dad came here because of WashU. You know, he had accepted a position at WashU. And so there were a lot of other Japanese immigrants also at WashU, you know, either in the medical school or in the research programs and things of that nature. So there was a smaller community based off of that, you know, where people just kind of, we got together with them, like we just almost felt like siblings growing up with, you know, their friends' kids and things of that nature. It was just in the larger grouping of when you go to grade school and, you know, you and the other kiddo from the other family are the only Asian kids in your grade, or, you know, things of that nature that happen. And not to jump ahead, but one of the things that that group of international wives did was to start the Japanese festival originally as a Washu cultural exchange, educating other people and sharing Japanese culture. So it was there. It's just a very small scale type of thing.
I think it's interesting too, because I think we all know that obviously, like, everybody used to talk about assimilation with Asians. And I think because that was such a thing, it's even hard to like connect with other Asians, especially like the term Asian. There's like so many different countries that that is part of. So I don't really remember where I was going with it, but I feel like maybe it's harder to build community with that kind of like narrative in mind, where you're not necessarily proud of being like the kind of, I don't know, you're not necessarily proud of your heritage, and that's why it's hard to build community. But I think, I mean, obviously that's changing, but yeah, I think that's why it's like kind of difficult for our community to build community. Sorry, I'm like.
Yeah, actually, I mean, it's hard to think about like what it would be like if I had like, you know, community or whatever that meant. But I remember like having this memory of like being in like middle school, and you know, I went to middle school in like New Mexico, which like, as you can imagine, did not have a lot of Asian people in it, but like, there were only like a couple Asian people in my grade. And I remember like, you know, clicking with one and, you know, making friends with her. And then I remember thinking that I needed to distance myself from this like Vietnamese girl, because I was like, you know, what if the white kids think that like I'm super, you know, like fobby or something? Like, it's like, it creates like kind of like a lot of inner conflict between like, it just doesn't allow for the complexities of like relationships and emotions and like the way people click together when you're just like perceiving it solely through race. And so, again, it's hard to say like what it would have been like if I, you know, had community and what that looked like. But like, I also think that I wouldn't be making the work that I do like if I hadn't like spent a long time trying to define myself just like without that measure of like what I'm supposed to be.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for sharing. Any other thoughts on this? And we're in the next question, we kind of continue on along the same line. So any other thoughts on this question? Which has been like six questions, but
yeah. Yeah, for me though, again, like I feel like everything for me nowadays is tied to both like as far as like my identity goes with my Asianness and also my queerness. And to be, I don't know, I guess depending on like where that community would have been at. It's like, again, I grew up in the church community here, and if we had been very involved, like I don't know like how much longer that side of me would have been, like the queer side of me would have been suppressed if I had been as deep as like a lot of people were. Luckily enough, you know, we were pretty disillusioned at a young age about church. So yeah,
I would add that I felt the exact same way. Like my dad was a pastor, so like I like had to go to church, and like I feel like a lot of immigrant communities, like church is like the way that they find each other, whether they're religious or not. But like growing up with like such a religious presence that I like didn't like fundamentally agree with, like also made me a little bit more distance from like my Korean heritage, because it seemed that those two had to go hand in hand. There wasn't any room for like any nuance within that.
Thank you everyone for sharing. So moving on to our next question number four. So along the same lines of the previous question, how is the relationship between your heritage and your work? And do you feel a sense of obligation to feature it in your art?
I don't know if it's an obligation per se. I think for me, it just sort of naturally happens. I don't know, I'll have to think about that a little harder.
Yeah, I feel like every time I've tried to be intentional in that I try to make it about that, I've never really felt as connected to the work. I don't think it has anything to do with because I don't have any connection to my heritage. I think it's just sometimes it's really easy to put yourself in a box when you're thinking of it in that term, in those terms. And I feel like my work is about my identity, and that is just part of me. That doesn't define, like, my heritage doesn't define everything that I am. And so I think it comes out, but I don't think it necessarily is the only thing that the work is about. And I just kind of let it happen naturally.
I think probably the worst work I've ever made in my life has been like the one where I was like really trying to put the heritage into it. Like, and I think that comes with like school, because you're like thinking of like, how do I like make work that's like personal and political? And like, there's many, many ways to do that. But I think personally, I didn't like doing it because it felt like I was having this weird, like kind of capitalistic, like relationship where I like needed to like mine my own family history in order to like make work for like the art world, which is like a lot of like rich white elites, like to like, you know, fawn over like my poor like upbringing or whatever. It's just like, I don't know, that's like very specific. But and I've actually felt like the opposite, like I needed to like in ways like kind of mask or like protect my heritage through my work. Granted, like I still talk about it all the time in relationship to the work, but it's just like not like super obviously there. Like I think a lot of work has a public life to it that's like what is immediately perceived, and then there's like the private life of it that like gets teased out through like deeper conversation and like contemplation. So yeah, I don't know, complicated.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, and so for me, it's not that I feel a sense of obligation or such. I think there's some aesthetics and things that just naturally occur from being just immersed in looking at art and just, you know, part of that cultural norm of looking at like kimono patterns and looking at florals and nature and these themes that sort of naturally you absorb. And then it kind of contributes to your aesthetic on how you see things. The flip side for me on this one is I find it challenging when people see my work and they're like, oh, I totally see that Asian theme in your work. And I kind of bristled at that, because if you didn't see me or you didn't see my name, which is as common as Mary in Japan, would you have that same reaction? Or, you know, and so I do have that conflicted feeling of, you know, I want my work to speak for itself. And so when someone else imposes that attribute, it's kind of like saying, oh, and you're so smart because, you know, you're Asian. It kind of has that same feeling at times for me where, you know, I get a little bit more hyper-conscious of how it may be perceived in that vein.
Yeah, people are going to project it whether you want it or not, either, like either way. So yeah, I feel that.
Yeah, I feel like whenever I, like, again, this is still pretty new to me for the past, like, handful. I feel like in the past, I've, you know, even before my, whatever I'm going through now, these transformations, but it's just, I put that out there, and I almost feel like I'm trying to fish for validation that of my Asianness sometimes, and I feel like I shouldn't have to do that. And as far as some, like, themes go in my art, like, a lot of people, some people know me for doing a lot of tiger related things. And that's sort of my subtle connection with, you know, my heritage, but also my love for nature.
Yeah, I actually almost feel like that part where you're processing your identity, like, or my heritage or whatever, it comes out like in therapy. And then I process it there, and then that becomes like that informs, like what I learn from there informs the work, but that doesn't mean that I have to be like obvious about things that I would consider as necessarily Filipino or not.
Yeah, the work has a tendency to like gut punch me, like being like, oh, this is actually about your identity, whether you wanted it to be or not. And that's kind of like amazing, because it's like, you know, I didn't like infuse it into the immediate like forefront aesthetics of the work, but it's like, I mean, like a lot of my work I'm now realizing has like roots in like artificiality and loneliness. And I think those are very kind of like common sentiments with like immigrants or like people of the diaspora. But that's also like a kind of greater, more universal theme that like is not limited to just like Asian people. So it's kind of funny and like poetic how like that stuff emerges, whether you meant it to or not.
Something that was brought up was the sort of topic of validation through art. Is that something that I think you brought that up? Is that something that others have kind of experienced? That's something that maybe you experienced from being like, you know, American or first generation immigrant. Is that something that is a common theme that you guys run into?
So I think for me, because I'm tackling a lot more of these social issues lately, I think for me, it's more of that sense of, you know, having faced enough racism growing up, having faced enough discrimination and having, you know, been told to go back to where you came from and people making fun of my name and all of those things. There's definitely the side of me that wants to sort of present things as look at the other side of the coin, like look outside of your own perspective, think more broadly, and wanting to look at community as a larger community and not just, you know, the small one that you may be in your day-to-day life. So in that sense, for me, it's a validation or it's a sense of, you know, looking at equity and looking at what's, you know, really, if we're in a global market, a global world, you know, look at our community as a bigger picture too. And I think in that sense, it's seeking that validation for me.
Anna, Rachel, anything else to add? Okay, if the answer is no.
I'm trying to like-
I'm the only one who needs validation.
Well, I'm trying, it feels like such a heavy, like loaded question. Cause do you mean like validation in terms of like feeling like us feeling validated from the work that we produce? Was that what the question was?
Just validation in general. So you brought up validation of like Koreanness through art, but what Yuko was talking about validation of the community and the sort of bigger picture of what it means to be like yourself and the art that you're producing. So whatever it means to you.
Yeah, I don't know if I have an answer.
And that's totally okay.
Validation's a tough topic, I feel like, especially for art making, because like ultimately we are in an industry that like involves like people, you know, liking things or, you know, things being validated or evaluated is what I'm trying to say. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. It just, you know, I think it's still taking me many years to learn that like you can't please everybody. And it's like, you know, not even my own family necessarily understands my work, even though it's kind of like about them. But you know, they're just like excited for me anyway. So and I think also like it's great to like make work that like other people feel like they have some relationship to, or like something, I don't know, they could just like look at and be like, yeah, like I feel that way too. And that in itself is like validation, whether it's, and that's like not monetary, it's not financial, it's not whatever. It's like purely like emotional.
I like that a lot actually, because it's like there's kind of a give and take. It's like fishing for validation, but also wanting to make work that is validating for others.
Yeah, so I think
there's two sides to that coin.
Yeah, actually that like totally, yeah, that totally makes sense. I feel like when I was younger, I seeked validation in that like I just wanted people to like the work. But the more that I'm realizing that being an artist is really about sharing experiences with other people and finding people who are interested in very similar things as you because of the work that you're making. Yeah, I think it has grown to that as I get older, and it feels good to not put the importance on being liked or money even.
Yeah, there are so many other things to gain from making art that is not like just financial. And I don't think a lot of us are in it necessarily for the financial gain or return. But yeah, like the you know, community or whatever, just like the time you get to spend like making something that's your own, like whether it's going to like make you money or not is important. That's like why people have hobbies. Like I think people sometimes like don't understand like why artists do what we do. And then I'm like, why do you spend like thousands of dollars, like, you know, on like watching films or like crafting things? It's like the same thing. It's just like what you do with your time that like you want to do.
Thank you everyone for sharing. Any other thoughts on this question? Or this topic, I guess, in general. Awesome. So moving on to the next question, kind of more St. Louis specific. So what are your thoughts on the arts culture in St. Louis, be it nonfiction or fiction writings, or local magazines like STL Magazine, Riverfront Times, our art galleries, our museums, music venues, festivals. And if you're not originally from St. Louis, why are you based here?
I moved here a little, it's not random, but it is a little random. My husband's family, part of his family lives here, and we moved here during the pandemic because his dad wasn't doing so well. So that's how I ended up here. So it's been a very interesting 2 years moving here, like during the pandemic, when I just haven't really met a lot of people because of that. But I feel like from what I've seen, I think that the art that comes out of St. Louis that I've noticed has been like, I feel like the artists here are really thoughtful. And I feel like the art community here has feels a little bigger than it was in Orlando. I feel like art is taken a little more seriously here, and there's a little bit more funding, which is so important. And I think that's why a lot more artists thrive here compared to where I was at before.
I think it's definitely a niche. Like, I don't know, like because of how small it is, it can feel more connected just because it's not so big and vast like those bigger cities can be. I don't know. We have a pretty like a very nice art scene here. I still think, you know, like everything could use some work, but for what it is, it's very nice and accommodating.
Well, it's definitely improving, that's for sure. And I want to say RAC is really doing quite a bit in terms of, you know, trying to get more artists connected with different resources and those grant programs and things like that. So it's nice that there are more resources that are reaching out to artists, trying to get them in the loop and, you know, really trying to get them to just network and connect a little bit better too.
Yeah, I would say, so I mean, I moved here for school too. Like I came to attend WashU, and again, from New Mexico, wasn't really like a comparable art scene. But I think it's a really accessible one. Like I think, you know, for like, you don't have to be like a hotshot painter in order to like, you know, have a show, like, you know, and like curators and like people here are just like, they have that Midwestern friendliness, you know, like they're like willing to talk, whereas like New York has like just such a different kind of culture, and one that's just like speedier and like, you know, there's just like things that about it that are great and horrible. And there's things about the St. Louis scene that are like good and bad too. And that's like the trade-off of living in like a smaller Midwestern city, is that, you know, it's more affordable to live here. And so therefore, like you have more access, you can take bigger risks. And again, like people give you the time of day here, whereas like you probably cannot like just go up and talk to like a museum curator like in New York or LA. It also, I mean, I think something that I'm seeing too, it also like depends on the kind of like sphere or like orbit of which art scene you're in. Like that ultimately, like we talk about like the St. Louis arts culture, but there are like many like smaller kind of fractions of that. And a lot of that can be like dictated by like the schools that you go to, which, and like, I think WashU has a tendency to like dominate a lot of that. Like, and I say that as somebody who like very much benefits from that, but yeah, I don't know. I've like loved living here like for 5 years. It's or like, I guess 9 years total. It's like sad to think about leaving it because in a way, like it is a great place to be an emerging artist.
I guess that's the thing though, is that it's like the emerging part. Cause then I feel like a lot of people here, that at least a lot of artists I've talked to just feel like they get to a certain point, like you just feel like you're emerging forever unless you like move somewhere else, and that's kind of like kind of where St. Louis feels a bit set, a little stagnant sometimes in the art scene.
Do you feel like the scene here as far as arts and culture is geared towards music, or do you feel like there's a balance between like print media and painting and that sort of section of art away from music? I feel like we have quite a few music venues here, maybe more than we have art galleries, though we do have, I feel like a good amount of just arts resources in general, but do you feel like it leans more music? And just in your experience, not like if you have a definitive count of how many art galleries.
Hard to say, hey, I'm not, it's like, I don't, I'm like painting illustrations, so it's like music isn't really, I'm not too sure. And like even then, it's like there's a lot of like little underground spaces, you know, you have to kind of consider as well, even with galleries, because then you have the bigger galleries, then you have people's own little studios, like private ones that have events as well.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like I don't know anything about the music scene actually. So but I don't know. In St. Louis, I feel like, you know, with the exception of like the pandemic time, like actually has like a lot going on. Like there are certain nights where I'm like, I have 5 different openings on my calendar and I'm like, how am I supposed to like get everywhere like in time and like budget your time? And, you know, only in St. Louis can you like drive to like ones that are on other parts of town, like, you know, in 15 minutes. So I don't know. I can't compare that to music. And I would say for music, it's probably the same, where there's just like so many different types of like music scenes, like, you know, like the underground, like punk rock scene is going to be different than like the jazz scene. So like, Yeah.
But whenever I think of like little niche music scenes, I always think about Cherokee Street and then whatever's going on down there.
Well, and I agree. I feel that, you know, those artists, once they hit a certain point, then they do kind of look into the bigger cities, musicians included, where it's kind of like, okay, you've reached a certain level in St. Louis, and then there's really just not as much to offer for continued growth. So then they switch gears. I do know several artists who still have their studios here, but all of their work goes to like a New York rep, you know, or a gallery that way. So that's how they've managed to kind of make a career out of it, where there's the affordability of living here, but then to sell their work and to get the prices that they feel is fair for their work, they're having to go to the coasts or to Chicago to get that put into place.
There really isn't like a kind of a critical mass of like collectors like in St. Louis. Like there are people who collect some stuff, but like, you know, that there's a reason New York and LA are the hubs, but it's also like probably would cost me like $2,000 to live in like the apartment that I, you know, the size of the apartment that I do now. So I'm just like, you know, I like appreciate like the nice like sleepy qualities of St. Louis and like you know, the just quick access to nature and not like waiting in like 2-hour lines for things, or like the fact that we like hardly have traffic. So yeah, like I said before, it's a trade-off.
Do you feel that there's anything wrong with artists starting here and then kind of getting their start here and moving somewhere else?
there's anything wrong with it necessarily, but you know, sometimes it's kind of sad to see those people go, because then you feel like you're kind of losing something when people decide to go somewhere else because they feel like St. Louis isn't enough for them. Because then it's like, what does it say about our city, you know?
Any other thoughts on this topic, or just St. Louis in general?
Well, I think it's interesting that there hasn't been a big push or some type of really study of what would help make people stay. You know what I mean? It's sort of like, oh, okay, they're moving on. And that's just sort of an accepted feeling versus, you know, hey, what can we do differently to then generate the collectors to come here and look? Or what can we do differently or better to help retain the really cool artists here and build up those art communities?
Something that was mentioned, that, and this kind of my background is in music and audio, so where most my knowledge comes from, but there are like artists that on, I believe that J Balvin, the like Latin pop singer, is one of the more notable ones, but he's like gone on record saying that he refuses to leave Colombia, that he'll go to LA, he'll go to New York, he'll tour, he'll do shows, he'll go to studios out there, but he's never going to leave his country as far as like where he pays taxes, where he like lives, where he like supports financially as far as like tax dollars, you know, they say like vote with your dollars. And so where he kind of like bases himself. And so maybe there's something to be said about encouraging artists to base themselves in different cities and still being able to, you know, talk to the curators and the buyers in New York and LA without having to move there. Cause that also increases the cost of living for those areas too, when you have great migration, as we've seen for both California and New York. I don't know if anyone wants to weigh in on that.
Yeah, I would say that, like, I feel like, especially with COVID, like the idea of like virtual visits and things became a lot more popular. And in a way, I feel like I got a lot more connected, like outside of St. Louis because of that, like openness. Like it wasn't just like a collector or like a gallerist, just like, you know, going to do studio visits in Brooklyn, like suddenly they're like looking outside of these city centers. And so I think that's like, you know, one thing we've gained from, you know, being more of like an interconnected, like, you know, more globalized like art community, maybe, is that like it's not just like what's like right around you. I mean, there's always going to be like the physical barrier of like we are like 1,000 miles away from New York, and it's like, you know, it is, I think, still cheaper to live in St. Louis and like fly to New York and LA occasionally. But yeah, I think there is a real, like, I mean, I ironically said this like when I'm going to be leaving, but like, you know, I could see a future where like you can have a practice based in St. Louis and can still be like sending work wherever.
Would anyone else like to weigh in? If that, we can move on to our next question. Any other thoughts? Anna, did you have something?
I just wanted to, I mean, it was, I just, from the 2 years that I've been here, I feel like I appreciate that about St. Louis. But I'm not like I haven't shown my work in 2 years too. So it's interesting. It's hard for me to weigh in because I feel like I'm not fully part of the art community here yet, but I do appreciate that. I feel like there's like space to not just think of yourself as an artist in St. Louis. Like the nature is amazing, and it's the fact that it's really cheap makes it like, I don't know, it's just such a, it's nice to have all those comforts and not feel like you have to like work all the time to succeed. So I appreciate that about St. Louis.
I think it's totally fair to like just acknowledge that like a city doesn't have like everything, you know. It's like not like the big culture, like it's like St. Louis again will not be like other places, but like I recently spent a couple weeks traveling in Europe and then like in New York, and I was dying to get back home. Like I was just like, I miss the Midwest like so much. And I think And I know what St. Louis is. It is what it is. And it's, I'm not like trying to pretend that like, I don't know, it is better or like equal to other cities. It just like like Anna said, like, you know, it has like amazing nature and like just like these different kind of cultural scenes that like you get to feel much more of a participant of because there's not as many people. So yeah, I love St. Louis.
I think it also like depends on what you're looking for. Like I've been to LA, I've been to New York a couple times and I love it, but it exhausts me every time. And I don't think that I am made to like live in those cities. And that's why I appreciate living here because I'm not trying to be like the most famous person out there. I just want to be able to live and produce my work and be healthy.
No, yeah, it is quite amazing actually with having like such a small community in all the communities here. Cause then you actually, cause I actually feel like I have the energy to dabble and check stuff out and really be a part of a little bit of everything, even if I don't fully commit to one thing.
Awesome. Thank you everyone for sharing. So we've gone to our second to last question. So how do you see yourself as an artist, which I'm sure is a very broad question, could have many, many answers. But are you concerned about how others perceive you artistically? Why or why not?
Yeah, it's interesting. Like, I feel like I've always skirted the line between artist and illustrator, and like the title like really stresses me out. Because you slap the word artist in there and it's like, well, are you showing? How often are you? Like, do you have how is your practice? Do you have a studio space? You have all these things. And I feel like I've just gotten to a place where as long as I'm making things that I feel like represent me well and I feel really proud of, that's all I really care about at this point. So I'm definitely, like I said it earlier too, but I'm like unlearning a lot of things, and that's one of the things that I'm placing less important on what that role means and more on just, because I feel like there's such like a big social pressure for artists to do certain things. I don't know if that's just because of like the art school that I went to. But yeah, I feel like the more I think about that, less the more proud I am of my work, and the more just the less pressure there is to perform and just to make things that I think are actually cool and good and interesting.
I think there is that pressure of like, oh my gosh, I have to stay current. You know, I can't just disappear and not do a show for 2 years, or I can't do it, you know, and the pandemic created the perfect excuse per se. But there's also that sense of, you know, if I'm super stressed out, then I'm not going to make great stuff anyway. You know, I'm not going to have the space in my mind to just really pull everything together. And it's really hard to remember to be kinder to yourself and not get sucked into that pressure of, oh my gosh, then if I'm not current enough, then people will look at that resume and just be like, oh, she hasn't done anything in a while, or, and just kind of remind myself that a lot of people don't, you know, and at some point the work just gets to speak for itself. And you do what you can when you can, you know, but that's a tough one to keep in my head.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting how any title comes with expectations. You know, and I try not to feel like I have to live up to those expectations, but I think this is always something in the back of my mind that is trying to, even if I'm not trying to at the same time.
Yeah, I think the thing I like the most about art, maybe this is kind of skirting the question but and going a little bit bigger, but like, I like that, like, I can't define anything about it. Like, you can't, or I don't know, in my opinion, I don't think you can like definitively say like one thing about art, like that it must look good, because like there's so much art that like is like purposefully abject, or like that it must be crafted well, because there's a lot of work that's like found object, like my work. And like there's or like that work needs to have a message to it, because there's also a lot of work that just like is what it is. And I think that's in a lot of ways also in terms of being an artist very freeing, because it's like, I don't know, there's just so many ways to like be an artist, and like whether you have a studio or not, or whether you have a full-time job or not that you're doing to support being an artist. And it's I think this is like more generally like a thing I've learned that like about just like growing up in general, is that like people don't really care, and like that's like amazing when people like, you know, it's like I feel like I had this weird anxiety that like all eyes were on me, that was like embedded in me by like my parents, and then like now I'm like, yeah, nobody, literally nobody's looking, and that's like the greatest freedom, because you know, and also like the work that you put out is just like a fraction of the work that you make. Like there's just so much that never leaves the studio, and like there's so like my practice is so much more dimensional than just like what gets put into the gallery and gets shown. And there's just like a lot of bad stuff that I also make too. And nobody's ever going to know that except for me. And like, I have to like be okay with that. And I think it's, yeah, it's kind of great to just like not be perceived like all the time. So,
having bad stuff is always fun, just because, you know, obviously with any profession that people, you know, show themselves, that you only ever get the polished versions of people and what they do most of the time. And then whenever people do put the bad stuff out there, it's just like, see, like, let's connect, because I'm still human. Like, I still make mistakes. Like, I want you to know that, you know, you can still do the thing. Like, we can still connect. And yeah.
Do you feel any pressure to put kind of what Anna was talking about of like, okay, am I an artist? Am I an illustrator? Do you feel a pressure to be like, what artist am I? Or do you feel like you can just say artist, or you can say, oh, I just create art, or I make art? Do you feel like there has to be a title, or people are expecting that?
To some extent, I feel like people do. Because, you know, when you say, because like, because of how broad artists can be, or like a creative can be, they want you to narrow it down, because it's like, I don't know, I guess when people think artists, I think they'll almost automatically probably go straight to like fine arts versus like, you know, performance art, or, you know, like other, you know, all the things out there. And that's why even for like the group that I made, I just called it the Creatives Collective, because I feel like creatives is just a little bit more ambiguous than putting artist down, because not everyone wants to call themselves an artist. It weighs heavy on the soul.
I don't know. My coworkers call me crafty all the time, and I'm just not quite sure what to do with it. So I'm just like, okay, sure. But I think, you know, like Jeeva was saying, it's so broad. It really is, however you choose to define it. I mean, you could be a crafter, you could be an artist, you can be, you know, whatever.
I feel like also it's kind of a state of mind too, and like the way you kind of like absorb things in the world and like kind of process and put them out. And the reason I say that is because I was like having a conversation with a friend recently, and she's like mainly doing design and illustration, and she's like killing it right now. And then like she was saying how like she's like, oh, maybe I'll like do this project, like maybe I'll be an artist again. And I was like, you're still an artist, like you've always been an artist, even though you've been under this like different kind of like category, where there's people who like graduate art school and they're like, that was horrible, I'm not gonna paint anymore, and then like, you know, they come back to it like 30 years later, and it's just like, you know, it's there isn't like a really a checklist for like, you know, what makes you an artist. And I think that's a good thing. Like, it does mean that like when you are talking about artists, you have to be pretty specific about like, you know, whether you're talking about a gallery artist or an illustrator, or like, you know, a performance artist, like, because ultimately people want to be able to like categorize and define things. But yeah, it also can be like a state of being, I think.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the times the trouble comes from like how you as a person is perceiving what it is that you're telling the world you are. Because like, I mean, I definitely have the same issue like you said, Rachel, where it's like, I've been doing a lot of illustration work and I feel like because I've been doing more illustration work than studio work, I don't feel like an artist anymore. But I always have to tell myself that I am always going to be an artist, because like being an artist is what informs like the decisions I make as an illustrator and as a designer. And I think that's why I do well in those different fields, is because I think like an artist. So it's nice to get reminded that a lot, because yeah, it's hard. It sucks to like not feel like an artist, but you have to like believe in yourself.
It's also amazing how just having the title of being an artist just also just changes just how you perceive the world in general.
Mm.
Like how I interact with everything, I feel. Yeah.
Do you feel like anyone can just be like, I'm an artist because they create? Is there like a gatekeeping to being an artist, or is that just because it's a broad term? It can really qualify for anyone. Something that you could brought up is like the term like crafter. I feel like that's a term that's kind of gained a lot of popularity in like the last 10 years with the rise of like Crickets and people who make t-shirts and, you know, Etsy sellers and things like that. Is that type of art just as valid?
I think so. You know, for me, like people, because I feel like when people hear the word like, you know, artist versus like crafter, it's like levels. Like you're like, you're almost an artist, but not really.
This is actually giving me a little bit of PTSD from art school, because I went to an art school that like they were so specific about how you were supposed to be an artist, and like a lot of the times I've felt like a sellout because of that, but yeah, that's a great comparison with like craft and art. I think it's just a different take to it, but that doesn't make it less. It's so silly to me that people think that still, because I'm not a crafter, but I respect a lot of people who can do craft. It's like such a specific and it's such a hard skill to learn, even like I can't even imagine knowing how to do those things. So I have like complete respect for people who are crafters. And yeah, I think that's why it's like so difficult to call yourself an artist. Like all these like things just pop in people's heads based on like what their own experiences within art have been before.
And then to add another facet, then there's your makers, you know? So it's like your maker versus a craft person versus, you know, an artist, and someone who's honed their craft. Does that mean they're still a craft, or is it a functional piece of work that makes it craft versus, you know, there's so many ways that this discussion can go, I think it's really, in some ways, it's up to the person to define, you know, how they want to define themselves. But there are a lot of discussions where people are saying, well, no, but that makes you a craft person because what you made was functional versus what, and you're just sort of like, oh, wait, this is getting way too complicated. You know, it's like, I make stuff for, you know, whatever. So I think it's something that really kind of shifts in definition depending on the person you're speaking with too.
For me, I think it's like a formality of like language too. I mean, because like for me, because of like the elite art education I have, like an artist is different than a maker and a crafter and an artisan or whatever. And it's like, and it's not so much that like I think there's a reason we have language to define things. Cause again, like a performing, like if you've ever been like I've done fairs that are like for performing arts and visual arts, and they are such different categorically. And it's like, I think important to know what you're getting yourself into. I think where the issue lies is with the value assigned to those areas. Like, it's like, you can be a craftsperson, but that doesn't, like, unless you see that as a derogatory thing, you know, that's really kind of what changes it. Like, if you put like a thrown bowl into, you know, into the Clayton art like market and then like, you know, sell it on like in a booth versus like put it into a museum and talk about like the implications of like ceramics and like culture and all that, like it really changes the context. And it's just like, And, you know, with that comes different like value assignments, like things in the fine arts world sell for like the most ridiculous amounts of money. But also I think it really just has to come down to like how you define yourself and what you care about. And I think that goes back to like the level of like gratification and like perception that we've been talking about, where it's like, people can look down on you for like making bowls or weaving baskets, but like, who cares what they think, you know? Like, let them just like be bitter and weird.
Yeah, I think a lot of this sort of conversation too comes down to sort of like classism as well. So something that is like someone making, you know, like macrame, like wall hangings, is going to look less of an artist than someone who is making a like, you know, hyper detailed Renaissance painting. So those types of comparisons also kind of come down to a lot of things that are cultural. So, you know, in certain cultural communities, basket weaving is a high art, and it is really, really hard. I couldn't do it. It's really, really hard. But people will, yeah, definitely compare those to fine arts, as everyone's been saying, and look at them totally different when they're just different skills, for sure.
Yeah, and again, art has like, at least in like the contemporary time, doesn't have a tie to craft too. It's like, we can't define how art is good, whether, because like my kid could make it. Like you hear that all the time, like, oh, my child could do that. And it's like, it's really not even about like whether you can do it, it's whether you did do it. And it's like, I think that for me, that's the indicator. Like, I think it's braver to just like make something, even if it's bad or good, than to just do nothing. And whether you're seeking validation from institutions or like you put a lot of money into a higher education, you know, degree to get that validation. I don't know. It's almost too much to think about. I think we should just like do what we like to do and just ignore everybody else.
Wholeheartedly agree. Any other thoughts on this question before we move on to our final question?
No, that just made me think about this thing where it was like almost kind of unrelated, but it was like thinking about like pumpkins and squash. It's like, I think the saying was like, all pumpkins are squash, but not all squash are pumpkins. So it's like, you know, all these things can be artists, but just because you're an artist doesn't mean you do like all these other things. Like, you don't identify with all the labels.
Awesome. Well, our final question is also a very broad question. I clearly like broad questions. So our last question is, what is the goal with creating art, and is there one?
I say no, but I'm on this like school, like this nihilistic school of thought where I'm like, art doesn't have to do anything. Like, it doesn't want to. Like, it's like, I mean, again, back to craft, it's like, why make the bowl? There's bowls at IKEA or like Target. It's like, it's just like a thing to do and like a moment to cherish. And it's like, I don't know, I think you get into really tricky territory once you start putting like value judgments on like what art should do or should not do, because then it also shuts down like so much else, and it can be classist and elitist as well. So just do whatever.
I think it's also an interesting question because, you know, it's also how someone's going to perceive it or how someone looks at it. You know, there's that whole dynamic that happens of like the person who created it and then the person who sees it or decides that it speaks to them in some way and takes it home, and someone else may just barely give it a glance. So it's completely subjective. It's, you know, it really is what speaks to someone, fantastic. It may not speak to someone else. And I think the same happens when, you know, you apply to art shows and things. Sometimes you get in, sometimes you don't. It's always an individual judgment call on the person kind of looking at your work. And as long as you make yourself happy, then, you know, there you go.
Yeah, I do think that it is just like a way to spend time. Like I think a lot of people who decide to be artists, that's just what they like to, what they enjoy doing and what gives, I mean, I think in a way it gives meaning in their life because they decide to spend an amount, a great amount of time in their whole life doing that. I've been thinking about art making recently as like alchemy. I'm like interested in like tarot and astrology and just thinking about the way art is very similar in that, like it's a way to alchemize your feelings and like process things through it. So I like thinking of it that way because I feel like it makes it more fun and it makes it, it gives what I, the way that I spend my time, meaning. And, I feel like it helps me in that way. It's like a form of therapy. So yeah, I think that's what I think about when I think about what the goal is.
Go right ahead.
No, I was going to ask, could you actually ask that question one more time? Sometimes questions go in and then, I don't know, they kind of got lost for a second.
Totally fine. So the question is, what is the goal with creating art? And is there one?
I feel like I would also say, oh, that is a, oh God. Maybe. Again, it's one of those things that I think it just depends on the person, because everyone's goals and how they go about life is just different. And for me, it's just making stuff that makes me happy at this point. And just hoping, you know, just hoping that other people enjoy it as well.
Do you think that people who make art with the goal of paying the bills, of making money, do you feel that that's a valid goal of creating art?
I don't think it's invalid, but they might be disappointed for a while, depending on, you know, I feel like some people can kind of jump off the dock and get that stuff going because they're really consistent and they just persevere through all of it. But for most people though, it's going to be a bit of a rough ride.
It's also a game of like connections and like elitism that like, you know, a few people can squeeze into. So it's like, I wouldn't even say it necessarily can like determine whether you're like a good artist or a bad one. It's more just like, who are like the rich people that you are connected with that like can get you into these shows in the first place? Yeah, I don't know. I think art, you just do it. It's just something people have been doing for like forever too. And it's just like cooking or music or something, you know, it's just like something that's just like somehow really quintessential to life as we just like are on this like spinning like sphere of rock, like be throttling through like the universe. Like it just, you know, it doesn't make any sense, but we're just doing it.
And, you know, there are enough people who have to do their kind of bread and butter pieces, like their production lines, and then they've got the freedom to then do, you know, something that's more what's totally up to them. But, you know, I would never fault anyone for saying, you know, for having some production lines that they need to do and they enjoy doing. I think it's got its own value as well, and not just the pieces that they create for what they would consider more fine art.
Yeah, I guess in the end, people just, you know, you got to do what you got to do to get to where you want to get to, and whatever that is for you.
Any other thoughts on this question? Or anything that we've talked about? Any final thoughts?
It's interesting. You've asked a lot of questions that kind of generate those things, those thoughts of like, you know, like a hierarchy. What's better? What's worse? What's more valid? What's more? And, you know, they all kind of roll into this massive thing where, you know, it's kind of hard to get into and define, because there are so many things that are so subjective in how it's done. And I think that's one of the challenges of art. It's not some thing that you can go down the checklist of, they've met this criteria, therefore it's this, versus, you know, there's the set of rules that define what that is, you know, so. But that's also one of the nice things about art. You can sort of define it yourself as well.
Yeah, it's also interesting too, because it's, you know, art is both both an individual experience and then also a collective one. So having us all here talking about it. Yeah, I'm definitely the kind of person where you bring up like these broad topics, and when it comes to like thinking on the spot, like I'm not always the greatest. So I might go to bed later thinking like, man, I could have said this one thing, you know, and just like, you know, break it down a little bit more later to myself or to somebody else.
I'm totally the same
you
way.
Almost want to reconvene like later.
Yep. Yeah, it's been so nice talking to you guys, because I feel I don't talk about art a lot, and I think that's why it's like hard to talk about it. But those questions were really nice, because they open so many conversations that I have with myself all the time anyway. So it's nice to hear other artists and like what everybody else thinks about it, or what you guys think about it.
Yeah, I was definitely like a little bit nervous at first, because, you know, it's, again, you know, depending on like who's going to be here, you know, it's you always worry that people are going to kind of look down on you just because you're not like, I don't know, I just kind of assumed everyone here was like full-time artists getting paid to do what they want to do, you know, you're just like, but no, it's like, we're all just human and we're still having to bust out a 9-to-5 just to get by. Even if we are, you know, even if we do have our stuff in another country right now, it's like, that doesn't mean that necessarily that you're thriving in that sense. Thriving in art, but, you know, it's like, when it comes to like financially, it's like, you still gotta make ends meet elsewhere. But it definitely made, it just kind of brings the humanness back to the artist experience, being able to open up these conversations with people.
And I think there's also just been that hesitation of admitting that you have a full-time job, because there's that whole aspect too of like, are you dedicated enough that you do it full-time versus, you know, are you kind of selling out because you have a day job? And so, you know, that's another conversation that pops up from time to time as well.
Well, thank you everyone for sharing. If any of our attendees have any questions or comments, if they'd like to put them in the chat or in the Q&A, we'll give a couple minutes for if our attendees have any questions. But thank you so much everyone for your thoughts and for the great conversations, really productive conversations, really respectful conversations as well. Something that's always nice about these panels is that I get to get connected with artists that are in the community, but also these artists, they get to meet each other. So I don't know if any of you were already familiar with each other, but now you are. Now you have a way to find each other's work and maybe see each other at different events or things around. And now you have a way to find events that are going on in the art community here in the city. Okay, so we do have a question here. Any advice on staying consistent with an art practice?
Definitely when going back to self-care, because in the end, if you as consistent as you want to be, like don't, like be realistic that it's not going to happen. You know, you're not going to be able to push stuff out every day and make beautiful stuff all the fucking time. I'm sorry, my bad. All the freaking time. My bad. So I got a sailor's mouth. I've been really good about toning it down. I'm so sorry.
Okay.
I'll get that out later. but yeah, it's just, yeah, you just really got to just take care of yourself and just know that it's you know, you. Okay, I lost my train of thought because I said that, but yeah.
I mean, I would say to that end, like, rest is productive too. Like, you know, I think the thing I'm like trying to contend with often is like having this like really capitalistic relationship to all my time, and like being like, oh, like I must be making something at all times of like my free time. And I'm like, and that's how I got super burnt out and like had to just like stop for a while. Something I would say, like, if you're like having trouble kind of getting back into the studio or like whatever, is honestly like the not fun thing of just like making it your job. Like I oftentimes don't want to go to studio, but I'm just like, we are going like 4 days a week. And even if I go for like 30 minutes and get like nothing done, I think I always feel better that I went and like don't have the residual guilt where I've been like sitting on my couch for 6 hours, like trying to get up to go to studio. Like I just, at this point, know it's just better to go. And usually things just kind of take off once I enter the space. Something I did this year, which I actually really need to do again, is like getting to the habit of drawing. Like I just do that in my apartment. But I set like a timer for like an hour and just was like, just draw for an hour. And, you know, from there I kind of like lost track of time, but it kind of had to take this like very kind of like regimented, just like really boring technique of like setting just like a very short goal for myself. To just get into the habit, because I think really it is like it a habit that you have to kind of cultivate over time.
Yeah, and I would definitely agree with like kind of switching it up. So, you know, I've seen like some people who do like realistic, like hyper realistic stuff all the time, and then when they're kind of in a rut, they'll decide to do abstract. You know, just like kind of throw themselves out of it for a moment and just try something else for a minute, just to kind of, you know, you just got to kind of balance it, because you're always doing one thing all the time. And you, like, you know, you get burnt out, and that's not good. And sometimes you can actually get some pretty good ideas from working with other like mediums that you're not used to. And then you bring that back into your work.
It looks like we have a follow-up also to this question. So art making can consume a lot of materials and create a lot of physical stuff. What do you do with the art you accumulate?
Storage unit.
Christmas presents.
Yeah, storage unit, friends, trying to sell the work.
Don't be a sculptor. I'm just kidding. No, but like for real, it's like everything takes up so much dimensional space. I just try to like move the, like I've been lucky, I've been like, I did that show for the Contemporary Art Museum, and like since then I have not had it come back to my studio, and I intended to like keep that way. But yeah, just yeah, like gifting is great. I don't know, I had a train of thought, but I lost it. I'll let somebody else talk.
Well, it depends on the medium too, because if I'm working in metals, I can always just melt it back down or solder things back together. So really depending upon what your medium is, you may be able to just simply kind of recycle it and repurpose it. If you have clay, you're kind of out of luck, and maybe with glass, depending on what it is, you know, you might be out of luck, but if it's repurposable, I'd say go for it.
Yeah, I was going to say, actually, a lot of my materials that I use are like secondhand, like mostly. And so I try to find like different ways to reuse things, which ends up making me look like a total hoarder, and like, it's not great for like space. But I think there's just so many things that like already exist that are like so interesting to work with. So I feel better kind of like, maybe from a, like, I don't think being an artist is like a very like sustainable, ecologically like sound thing for the most part, but it makes me feel a little bit better to like use things that, like, you know, or like when I did painting, I used to just like, you know, paint over like old things that I didn't want anymore and use it as a new canvas.
I'm also wondering if you have artist friends, maybe you guys can kind of collectively bring all your stuff out, and then if you can sort of reinvent some things too, that might be a fun way to spend an afternoon too.
Mixed media project. So I have another question. How do you deal with feelings of being in between cultures?
For me, it's trying not to perceive it as feeling in between. It just, like, it is what it is. Like, I think Like growing up, I was like, oh, I'm 50% Korean, 50% American. But really, it's like, I am 100% Korean. I am 100% American. And that doesn't make sense, like numbers wise. But like, that just like is the experience. And I think leaning more towards one or the other does not mean that I'm like lacking something necessarily. So I think it has to do a lot with mindset. And also, like, it's not always good and chill and like good vibes. Like, there's some times where I just am really wrestling with it, or like feel a lot of like kind of like, you know, deep pain from like thinking about like culture and whatnot. But I'm a fan of the saying that like no feeling is final. It's like okay for things, your feelings to change on things. And yeah, I don't know.
It's also that sense of you're bridging a couple of different cultures, but that's also just you, you know, it's what makes you unique. It's what makes you bring a different lens to your experiences. You know, and the nice thing is you don't have to choose, you know, you don't have to pick a side or pick one or the other. It's just a part of who you are, and, you know, and that's all good.
Yeah, for me, like, I take that like question very literally because of being, you know, half and half. But yeah, no, I definitely agree with Yuko about bridging versus just seeing it as just like two separate things.
Yeah, it's nice to tell yourself that it's okay to have multiplicity and to relate to different things. It just makes you a more, it just gives more dimensions to yourself. And that's actually, I think once you like see it that way, and it actually gives that feeling value where you're like, oh, I know two different things and not everybody has this experience, but, and it's not easy, but I learn a lot of things from it. So that's, I think it is kind of a privilege in some ways.
I would also caution against, you know, I think for some people who don't have a broad experience, there is a tendency to want to compartmentalize parts of you for, you know, within the context of what they know. And just keep in mind that that's what they're coming from. That doesn't mean you have to accept that, you know, and I just don't feel that those efforts to put you in a certain compartment with those expectations and those stereotypes or whatever that people may try to apply to you, I just don't think that's something you need to take in. But that's just my two cents.
Thank you, everyone. We have another question. What do you think about creating art for yourself and never showing that work in public? Healthy or unhealthy?
I read this article. That this art, it was like an interview with this artist that I really like. And she said, it's important to only show 10% of your work because in a way, or no, it's important to not show all of your work to the world because in a way it keeps you free to not constantly be showing your work to the world. And I thought that that was really, that kind of like really rocked my mind because I'm like, I feel like there's always a need to like show what you're producing all the time because of like Instagram culture. And at the end of the day, like what's important is like what the art is doing for you, what your work is doing for you.
Yeah, and when I think of that too, it's kind of like when I think about vulnerability, like I feel like you shouldn't have to be like, you shouldn't have to show everything, you know, especially when you're like just literally with art and then also with yourself, which again, your art can be very personal, which I guess in this case, were they asking about more personal stuff? Creating art for yourself, yeah. Okay, I'm just gonna expand on that and I lost it, so I'm just gonna leave it there.
Yeah, I feel like I'm totally guilty of like being part of like the Instagram culture. I mean, like, I think it's also like in a weird way, kind of like part of my job as it stands as being an artist is like reminding people I exist on the internet, and like that's just like my way of doing it. But actually, like I feel like I get immense joy from like sharing my work, and like in a way it doesn't totally feel complete unless like somebody else is looking at it, because also there's this like very I don't know, the way that my work is, like, to me, it's just, like, whatever, but then, like, to somebody else, it's, like, totally surprising, and I kind of have to, like, remind myself that, like, you know, it's not just dead, because it's, like, dead to me, but in a way, like, I, sometimes on Instagram, I post things that, like, never get shown, like, you know, in a gallery ever, and it's, like, kind of nice to just be able to, like, you know, just show, like, these weird little experiments that are happening, because it kind of takes the pressure off of, like, I need these, like, high finish, like, photos of, like, things installed in galleries, like, yeah, I mean, I think it really comes down to, like, whether you want to share that work with people, and I think the internet's a great way to share things with people that doesn't have the same kind of, like, barrier, that like physical galleries have. It's just like really based on like your temperament and like, you know, what you have to, what you want to like offer out to the world, and whether that's like exhilarating to you or like exhausting to you, or, you know, sometimes it's great, sometimes it's bad, you know, you can go back and forth between the two. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
And I think it also depends on how you define healthy and unhealthy. Like obviously, the reason why you do something, you know, that just kind of, it's up to you. And I definitely agree with Rachel, because it's like I also put my stuff out there as well, like a lot of it, almost all of it, and I do enjoy people being able to see some of those small things that are like unpolished. But I always wanted that, but I guess, but to be fair though, I guess with art, you know, it's like a part of being an artist is your art, which you hope in the end people like it because of your stuff. They enjoy your stuff, they connect with your stuff. But sometimes a lot of it comes down to kind of selling yourself in a way. I don't know if that makes sense. Like,
I feel like if it's sort of your own creative diary, you know, think about that in terms of, you don't sit there and read off your diary to everybody, you know, but if it's like you're creating something that's sort of like a diary that's dimensional or whatever the case may be, you share it when you want to and you're ready, you know, but in the meantime, yeah, hold on to it. I mean, you're not sitting in a corner like Gollum going, my precious, with it. It's, you know, it's just something that is like your own, you know, kind of personal expression, and it's okay to hold on to that. And whenever you're ready, then you can share it.
You're unmuted, but we still can't hear you for some reason.
Can you hear me?
Now we can.
Okay, sorry. My AirPods died and I had to take them out. Screwed everything up. What was I say? Oh, there's also like, there's artists that like don't show work until like the end of their life, or like people who have like retrospectives after they've like died, you know? So it's like, I mean, it's not necessarily like a one-to-one relationship with like, I don't know, just, yeah.
Well, we're at 8:01, so this will be our last question of the night. Do you feel a burden with holding on to your style or what people know about your work, mostly aesthetically?
If only I had a style. I feel like my art is always changing. And I tend to go on long hiatuses, like just sporadically. And all of a sudden when I get back to art, like it, you know, I could. Sometimes I wish I could just go back and hold on to those old styles, but that's just not how it works. It's just ever changing.
No, I feel like style is, I think like I've had that conversation in art school too, where like the idea of style is kind of like almost like a trap, like it limits like what you feel like you can explore. Like I would say that there are things that are part of like maybe like visual vocabulary, if you want to give it a term, but that doesn't mean I always have to use the same things. And I feel like I'm in that kind of moment where I feel the pressure where like people want to see the one kind of thing I make right now only. And it's like, I want people to leave me alone so that I can like make, you know, more daring work. But that also means like not pleasing everybody and what they want to see. But also like realizing that like there are like multitudes of ways to make work that like can emerge from yourself. And like, it's in a way, I think a disservice to like just stick to one style. And, you know, if there's a way you are comfortable working with, that's like, that's also great. But, you know, it's, you're the one who sets your own limitations in a way.
And also I think style, you know, that can also be kind of, you know, I guess when people think style, it's literally like, if with art, there's like, people see your art and it's like, oh, that's your art. Like, cause they recognize your style. But then I feel like style can also be something a little bit more nuanced, like what your work's about, for instance. Yeah,
I totally agree. I feel like style is just about the decisions you make, and those decisions can change at any point in your life. And so I really like thinking about it too, like it's ever changing, and it's nice to give yourself rules, but it's also okay to break those rules sometimes.
Because honestly, how can you grow if you don't?
I think about how boring my life would be if I just made the same thing until I died. Like, I think that would, if I couldn't surprise myself in any sort of way, then I feel like I've lost fulfillment as like an artist.
And we get constantly inspired, you know, by the things around us and other artists, and just, you know, all of those other things kind of have a space to fit in there too. So that's going to change and shift as well.
Awesome. Well, any final thoughts? Thank you to our audience for the great questions. Thank you, our panelists, for great responses. Any final thoughts?
This was such a thoughtful conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank all of you.
And also, Anna, earlier you mentioned this like quite a few questions ago, but you were like, you said something about being proud of yourself. And I love that. Be proud. That's something that I don't ever have enough of for myself sometimes, because I'm, you know, you're always your own worst critic. And it's good. I think it's very healthy to have that, to be proud of yourself, because, you know, you can't expect other people to say that. I think this year, for the first time, my mom said something about being proud of my art. And I was like, are you okay? I had a moment. I'm proud of you all.
I guess I'm going through this period where I'm like, now is trying to be okay with people not being proud of my work too, which is also like in itself a freedom, which also came from watching Everything Everywhere All at Once, which was great. I like how much therapy has come up in this, and I'm like such a proponent of therapy too. Like, art is one part of your life, but also you gotta have like your other stuff sorted out too. It was a really great conversation. Thank you to the audience for sticking through 2 hours of a panel on Zoom. Really appreciate it.
Absolutely. This was great. And I'm just a little sad that we weren't all in a coffee shop, you know, talking till 2 a.m.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. So this was recorded, so we'll be putting captions on it so that way it's accessible. But once captions has been on, it's 2 hours, so it'll take a minute to put captions on it. But once captions have been put on it, it'll be on our YouTube channel, which you can find through our website. Under Creative Experience, which is in our little toolbar at the top of our website, you can get to our YouTube channel there to be able to rewatch or to share. And thank you everyone for sharing and being really vulnerable and just giving us your time, which I know is very, very valuable. So thank you so much.